Hey you guys, it's Peter and welcome to my channel, Peterisms, where I tell stories of my life and just little things I've learned as I have grown into the person that I am today. And I have kind of a different video to do today. A friend of mine recently traveled to California and she brought me this book back and she was highly, highly impacted by this book. And it's different than a book that I would normally read. So I was sitting there the other night and I just kind of like started going through it and I was equally as impacted. And I thought, I'm gonna share some pieces of this on here and just what I think about these passages, which I think are so profound and yet so simple. It's a book of simple prose. And the book is called Inward and it's by Young Pueblo. And I am going to link it below in case you guys are interested in getting it for yourself. I think it's like $13.99 on Amazon. I just looked it up to make sure it was on there. And it says on the back, true power is living the realization that you are your own healer, hero, and leader. Let me read you a little bit about the author. Diego Perez is the writer behind the pen name, Young Pueblo. The name Young Pueblo means young people. It serves to remind him of his Ecuadorian roots, his experiences in activism, and that the collective of humanity is in the midst of important growth. His favorite word, liberation, took on a deeper meaning once he started meditating Vipassana, as taught by S.N. Gokna. Today, he meditates, writes, and speaks as a way to serve. And I horribly mispronounced some of those words, but I apologize. So anyway, but I was so moved by this book, and I just wanted to share a couple of passages with you. And the first passage, these are at the beginning, but that I want to share with you was, hold on just a second. Okay. To solely attempt to love others without first loving yourself is to build a home without a strong foundation. And, you know, it's really, really interesting that he uses this analogy of building a home. For years, when I worked in treatment and, you know, working with people that were in early sobriety, one of the things that I would say to them, you know, is that they would immediately want to get into a relationship or immediately, like, go and get the job of their dreams or go back to school. And I would say, you know, you need to take a year to just focus on yourself. And it's very similar to building a house. You know, you're going to build a foundation first, and you want to have a sturdy foundation, you know, and a sturdy skeletal system to the house. You wouldn't look at the house, like, as you're laying the foundation and go, I'm going to go buy the curtains right now, because we're not to the point yet where we need to be worried more about the foundation of the house so that it lasts for 100 years versus the beautification of the house, if that makes sense, right? Like, that can come later once we have laid down this sturdy foundation. So I think it's interesting in, you know, reference to loving yourself and loving others, he talks about the same thing, that we really can't love another person until we can first love ourselves fully and solely. And I think that's a really interesting perspective, you know? And to say it just, you know, so simply in, you know, what is it? 6 lines. To solely attempt to love others without first loving yourself is to build a home without a strong foundation. 3 things make life harder: not loving yourself, refusing to grow, and not letting go. I lived so long with a closed heart, not because I was afraid to get hurt, but because I was afraid of the pain I had hidden away. And you know, when I read that one, it was like, boom, right in my face. Cause I was like, wow, that's like really, really true. You know, like, I think a lot of times so many of us are afraid to fall in love again after we've been hurt, you know, or we say, oh, I'm just really guarded. I'm just really guarded because I have trust issues. Do you hear that from people? I hear that. I feel like I hear that from people all the time. I'm really, really guarded. I have trust issues. I don't trust people a lot because I've been really hurt in the past. And it's like, they always kind of nod like that should make sense. And you know, it's interesting because I'm kind of the person that like just continues to get back up on the horse, even giving people sometimes 5th, 6th, and 7th, you know, chances where they continue to hurt me. And I'm like, God, why am I so stupid? But you know, I'm not really sure who loses out in that experience because I've learned through all of that and I've had those experiences, whereas they must not mean a lot to that person. But I think what happens, you know, as we meet somebody new and we're afraid to like fall in love again, I don't think that it's because we're afraid to get hurt, as he suggests. I think it's really because we're afraid of the past pain that we've experienced being reminded again if we fall in love again. So if we go through those things again, are we going to experience the same things? It's unearthed pain that we have not dealt with yet. And so to be able to love again fully, we need to deal with that pain from the past relationships. And I think when, you know, we talk about bringing baggage into our new relationships, which all of us do, you know, I mean, I've done it, we all do it. I did it in this relationship that I'm in. And I think that it's really, really important, you know, to look at that pain, to look at that baggage and say, what am I so afraid of experiencing again? Am I afraid of rejection? Am I afraid of falling out of love? Am I afraid that they're gonna fall in love with somebody else? What is it that I'm afraid of? Looking at it, not being afraid and addressing that issue. And that's really, I think, you know, how we move forward. And before we can heal and let go, what ails us deeply must first come to the surface. And that's exactly what I was just talking about, you know, is that for us to really deal with the pain and for us to grow as human beings and learn from the experiences that we've gone through, we have to look that pain in the eyes and say, I'm not afraid of you. Okay, I'm going to deal with you on my terms and look at it face to face, whatever that pain is, whatever those deep wounds are, right? Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that we sit at home with a journal and we do that, because some of our pain is deeper than other people's, right? And, you know, there are some of us that have such deep underlying pain and wounds associated with things that have happened to us that it is not safe for us to not do that at the confines of a counseling office or a therapist or a psychiatrist. So if you've had wounds that are that deep, wounds that run that deep, please seek out some professional help, okay? It's one thing to go through a breakup, and that's hard enough. A lot of us need to have counseling or coaching or, you know, therapy to deal with that. It's another thing to go through extreme feelings of abuse in your life or extreme experiences of abuse or other traumatic events, right? So those things probably aren't pains that we can stare in the face and say, I'm not gonna, you know, I'm gonna deal with you on my own terms. But most of it, I think, we have to be willing to work on, period, you know? And those hardest things in my life, like for example, when I did my 4-step, so when you're in a 12-step program, you do a 4-step, and it's making a searching and fearless moral inventory of your lives. And what was so interesting to me was, I put it off and I put it off and I put it off, and I was terrified to do this. And what you do is you make a list of your resentments, you make a list of your fears, and you make a list of your sexual conduct. And I was so afraid to sit down and actually write those things out. But what I realized was, it wasn't the things out there that made me scared, because I already knew what the pain was. I already knew what those horrific things were that I had done or participated in or that had happened to me. I already knew those things, right? What I couldn't deal with was writing them on paper and seeing them and making them come alive. And I think for a lot of us, that's what's terrifying. But then to sit down in the 5th step with another human being and process those things and how they had affected me in my life, and to try to take some look at, did I have any kind of part in that? You know, or do I have any part in allowing it to continue to affect me today? Then I had a little control over what was going on. I had a little bit of taking back the pain that had happened to me in my life. And I think that's paramount for any of us to be able to grow. But we first have to be willing to address those wounds. They just can't stay stuck forever, or it's not healthy for us. And then I'm going to read you my favorite. I love this the most. And I'm not done with it. I'm only about a third of the way through. So you can trust that this book's going to come out in other videos. I spent so much time creating versions of myself that were far from the truth. Characters I would perform, depending on who was around. Layers that could hide the inner dance of turmoil between my lack of confidence, the pain I did not understand, and the uneasiness that comes with reaching out to others for the love I was not giving myself. And I think this is my favorite, because so often in my life I have worn masks. I haven't done it in quite some time. My mom dying really changed this for me. I was, you know, no longer willing to live my life per other people's requests. You know, it was important for me to live to the beat of my own drum and what made me happy. And I had to be my crazy, kooky self and make myself happy even at the expense of upsetting other people or, you know, them not understanding why I needed to go for the things in life that were important to me or do the things that were important to me. And, you know, I think I've hurt some people along the way. There's a great song by, you know, I think Joni Mitchell sang it first and then Judy Collins, Both Sides Now. And there's a part at the end where she talks about her friends and they, it says, you know, old friends shake their heads and say that I've changed. And, you know, it's hard, I think, for a lot of our friends when we do change. And change can be good and change can be bad. And change when we are fully realizing who we are and we stop playing charades for everyone around us, okay? You know, to our supervisor, be a yes man or a yes woman. And to our parents, you know, just always doing everything they ask for us. And for our siblings and our family members, you know, picking up the phone and always being there for them. And to our friends, you know, like listening to them cry and all of it, you know, all of that, right? And always being fun and on when we're out and never being sad because people don't like a Debbie Downer or never being honest with somebody about how we truly feel inside. And then we come home and the mantra that we hear in our head is, nobody understands me. Nobody understands me. I feel so all alone. And sometimes in my past, I have felt more alone standing in a room of people than I have felt all by myself because I wasn't being true to who I am. And today I am true to myself. And I am true to the beat of my own drum, and so should you, because we only have one life, and that's all that matters. And we need to learn to love ourselves, we need to free ourselves from the pain, and then we need to live the best life possible. I'm so thankful that my friend gave me this book. This book, I mean, it's so funny that it says in here that, what it's saying here, something about liberation. His favorite word, liberation, one of my favorite words is liberation too. And to only have read like 20 pages of this book so far, and to feel liberated is amazing. I love you guys, and I will see you tomorrow. Bye.